Stephen Porges' polyvagal theory was developed in 1994 to explain the differences in stress responses between mammals and older creatures such as reptiles and amphibians. The main issue here is how the body responds differently in situations where there's safety compared to situations where there's danger or threat. All creatures, from amoeba to humans, have two main modes of operation. The first is energetic phases, which allow us to look for food and protect ourselves. The second phase is a rest phase, where we can sleep, digest food, and repair any damage we've incurred while we've been running around. The running around mode, dominated by the sympathetic nervous system, which is shown here in red, pumps up our bodies so that we can act effectively. This can happen in a safe environment, such as going out for a hike with friends or working in the garden. Or it can happen in a dangerous environment, like being yelled at by a stranger or hearing an explosion. Either way, the sympathetic nervous system responds to increase our readiness for action. The rest-promoting parasympathetic in blue moderates the go-go-go energy of the sympathetic nervous system, and it calms our bodies down. The two systems work in a continuously changing balance to control our energy levels and much, much more. The parasympathetic has two branches, which calm activation in distinctly different ways. The more modern and nuanced branch, made up of the ventral vagal and other cranial nerves, comes to the fore when we feel safely connected to others. This is the system that helps to calm a crying child. Eye contact, body contact, gentle soothing voice, and the rocking of a loving caregiver stimulates ventral vagal settling, and the child's heart rate slows down and their crying stops. The older and less evolved branch of the parasympathetic nervous system is made up of dorsal vagal nerves, and it immobilizes us. When we're safe, this stillness gives us an opportunity to sleep, digest food, rebalance systems in the body, and repair any tissue or cell damage. It is a good thing. When we're in danger, though, the immobilization slows down all non-essential functioning in order to keep us safe and conserve energy. If you've ever seen a lizard freeze like a statue, you've seen the dorsal vagal system in action. Muscle movement, breath, heart rate, thinking. All of these functions slow down until the danger has passed. That may sound really familiar, because when we're depressed, we have many of these same symptoms. Difficulty thinking, slow movements, low heart rate, pale skin. And I'd just like to share what Peter Levine says about that immobilization system. This again is in the presence of threat, what our nervous system does. The signs of this are that we have unfocused eyes, we breathe much more shallowly, much less frequently. We have a slower and fainter heart rate. Our pupils constrict. Sometimes what I see in clinical practice is people will close their eyes. They're peering at the light like this because it's just too bright. Their skin will have fewer red tones. It'll look grayer and paler. There won't be a lot of unnecessary movement. They may collapse forward. They might report symptoms of spaciness or feeling unreal or feeling just out of their bodies a little bit, numb, fuzzy, things like that. And what also happens is because all non-essential systems are getting shut down, we also end up with gut issues where we're not digesting our food well, where we might have persistent pain. And people might report disengagement from activities that they enjoy. Now, I'm sure that you recognize that there's a strong overlap between these systems, these symptoms, and the signs of depression. So from the polyvagal perspective, depression is shutdown. It's the older, unmyelinated, less effective system of immobilization. And that's mediated by the dorsal vagus nerve. And it takes place in an environment of danger or stress. This really makes sense when you look at the kind of situations where depression develops. The circumstances under which we become depressed are, they're often moments in our life when we are feeling a lot of stress and we don't have a lot of social support. So when you think about things like during or after an important relationship breaking down, or after a job loss, or going through stress at work when you might be targeted for bullying or treated differently or treated inappropriately or unpleasantly. After giving birth, you know, there's a big change in life at that point. Or while living with a chronic health condition. But these are all circumstances in which we're dealing with stress that's going on and on and on, and where we're more likely to fall into that state of nervous system shutdown. A way of coping and immobilizing us, hoping that the stress is going to pass. In these moments and in these situations, our nervous system chooses for us. And that's what I think the most important message is. We don't give permission for this to happen. We don't choose it actively. And so often people with depression are told that they've developed the disease because of some deficiency on their part. And that is simply not true. So I want to make that very clear. I want to try a short exercise with you, if that's okay. And so this involves your hands. I'd just like you to put your hands together like this. And I'd like you to gently push with the right hand and then to push back with the left. And just notice how soft a response that can be. You know, it doesn't have to be strong. It doesn't have to be powerful. And just think, this is how the ventral vagal system pushes against the sympathetic system. This is how that social connection pushes back against the go, 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 go of our nervous system. It's very soft. It's very nuanced. It can get to just a particular millimeter on the curve and work there. It's very responsive to the situation around it. Now I'd like you to push really hard with your hands and push with your left and push back equally with your right. And I'd like you to look at what your hands are doing. You know, if you're able to push equally, then what you're getting is immobilization. What you're getting is something really equivalent to what the dorsal vagal, that immobilization system, does in order to match and shut down the go, go, go of the sympathetic. And I don't know about you, but I'm starting to feel a little stress in my upper arms and my shoulders as I do this. So it's okay to let go, but I'd like you to think, if you had to hold this pose for days, for weeks, for months, it would be exhausting. And we would end up, and definitely do let it go and shake yourself out, you would definitely end up with the kind of symptoms that we're talking about with depression. You would end up with fatigue. You would end up with, you know, not really wanting to get up and do things in your day, not wanting to take part in activities, even ones that you really, really enjoyed in the past. So this is why with depression, we end up with so many symptoms in so many different parts of our bodies. But there is some fascinating new research about that. And so I'd just like to share that with you.